The first intercontinental nuclear bomber had a strange design. It had massive propellers that faced backwards. Of course, the B-36 Peacemaker wasn't the only well-known aircraft with rear-facing blades. The XB-35 Flying Wing, which was a predecessor to the stealthy B-2 bomber. The Rutan Voyager, which became the first airplane to fly around the world without stopping or refueling. And even the Wright Flyer, which performed the first powered, sustained control flight in 1903 by the Wright brothers and marked a new era in aviation, all had rear-facing propellers. Which made me wonder, how come over 100 years ago, propellers were often placed on the back of airplanes? And why are they now mostly installed on the front? What I found out was a lot more fascinating than just aesthetics. But why putting propellers on the front makes airplanes more quiet? Why aircraft with rear-facing propellers can only operate on paved runways? And how installing an airplane's engines backwards contributed to the first ever loss of a US nuclear weapon is not what you think. The most fundamental difference between having the propeller in the front or back of an airplane is that a front propeller pulls the aircraft forward, which is why they commonly refer to it as a tractor configuration, while having the propeller on the back pushes the aircraft forward, hence the name pusher configuration. We all intuitively know that pushing an object is easier than pulling it. But does that also apply to airplanes? It didn't take long for the Wright brothers' revolutionary invention to capture the attention of the US military, which needed a way to perform observations from the sky, or as they now call it, for reconnaissance missions. The 1909 Wright military flyer became the first military aircraft ever procured for a sweet price of $30,000. Its two propellers were on the back, because that left the front wide open for aerial observation. Well, minus the giant elevator in the front, which was used to pitch the aircraft up and down. But Orwell and Wilbur Wright had an even more important technical reason for this design decision, because they believed a propeller on the back made their airplane proper. Get it? Wind tunnels are crucial for understanding how objects move through air. That's because during flight, there are four fundamental forces at play, which are lift, weight, thrust, and drag. Generally speaking, you want a design that reduces drag, and this can be visually observed in a wind tunnel. Putting the propeller in the front of the aircraft would most certainly disturb the airflow behind it, which means the wings have to fly through turbulent air, and that translates to more drag and a less efficient flight overall. By putting the propellers on the back, the Wright brothers aim to minimize this disturbance. As you can see in this wind tunnel test, no propeller on the front allows for a smooth flow of air over the wings and the fuselage. But that's pretty much where the benefits of a pusher aircraft end, and its long list of downsides begin. Once the laminar airflow goes over the aircraft, it can't help but become somewhat disturbed, even when going over smooth surfaces. In a pusher configuration, it's this turbulent air that is then ingested by the propeller on the back. And because propeller blades, just like airplane wings, produce lift and drag, turbulent air makes them less efficient. At the same time, this turbulence causes vibrations in the blades, which is then passed on to the engine and to the fuselage of the aircraft. And if the propellers are behind the wings, this can further increase the vibrations in the blades. That's because the air that flows over the wings has lower pressure, and the air that flows under the wing has higher pressure. This means that each blade of the propeller goes through high and low pressure air with each revolution of the propeller, and this results in additional vibrations in the blades. Interestingly, the frequency of these vibrations changes with the engine's RPM, airspeed, and the aircraft's angle of attack. And more vibrations means more noise. This is why most pusher aircraft are unusually noisy at some specific combination of airspeed and angle of attack. Now, using propellers with an odd number of blades can typically reduce these vibrations. That's because an odd-bladed propeller lacks the perfect symmetry of an even-bladed propeller, and this can help reduce the buildup of resonance in the propeller. Here it is, in case you forgot what ground resonance can do to helicopters. Another downside of having propellers on the back is that anything that gets loose would get sucked into the propeller arc and damage the blades. This could be anything from bullet casings being ejected to the pilot having to bail out of the airplane. Not ideal when your emergency plan involves jumping into a propeller. In case something really bad happens mid-flight, some airplanes are equipped with emergency parachutes, which are total lifesavers. But having the propellers on the back can complicate how the parachute can be deployed, because it would naturally want to move back, where it would be cut by the propeller blades of a pusher airplane. The situation is not much better on the ground. Foreign object debris is a big hazard to any aircraft, especially if it has a pusher design. That's because any dirt kicked up by the nose wheel is much more likely to hit the prop arc if it's located in the back. This alone could limit the operation of a pusher aircraft to only paved runways. Prop strike is another serious issue. Of course, in this example, it happened to a tractor design, because the pilot had to slam on the brakes. But propeller clearance has to be taken into account for pusher designs, because if the angle of attack is too high during takeoff or landing, the propeller can hit the ground. You could, of course, use a smaller diameter propeller, but that just means less power. Another issue is engine cooling. Propeller aircraft use air to cool down their engine, as opposed to using water, because water is heavy to carry. Now imagine a tractor configuration aircraft sitting on the runway with its engine running. The airflow from the propeller is naturally forced through the engine to cool it down. But this is not the case in the pusher configuration, and so special considerations should be made to cool down the engine. The B-36 Peacemaker, which also used the pusher design, experienced multiple engine fires, but not because the engine couldn't be cooled down. The R-4360 engine used on the Peacemaker had been originally designed for the tractor configuration, where the air would go through the air intake, then through the cylinders, which warmed up the air, and finally through the carburetor. But in the B-36's reversed pusher configuration, the carburetor sat in the front. This meant that as cold, humid air came in, ice would start to build up inside the carburetor, causing the fuel mix to become too rich, which in turn led to the unburned fuel igniting in the exhaust. Turns out reversing airflow also reversed reliability. This flaw caused multiple fires in flight, and contributed to the first loss of a U.S. nuclear weapon in 1950. Given all these challenges with the pusher design, you might be wondering why a lot of World War I aircraft used the pusher configuration. Well, that had to do with the military. See, during World War I, military aircraft did a lot more than fly reconnaissance missions. They needed guns to shoot down other aircraft. But at least until the end of 1916, pusher aircraft such as the Airco DH-2 fighter were preferred by the British Royal Flying Corps, because you could easily put a gun in the front and shoot at the other guy's airplane without worrying about destroying your own propeller blades. But in 1915, a Dutch aircraft designer created a mechanism that synchronized the firing of a machine gun with the blades of a moving propeller. This effectively eliminated the risk of a bullet damaging the blades. I don't know how else to say it, but that Dutch designer was a smart fucker. What? His name was Anthony Fokker, and he was pretty darn smart. Alternatively, just having a twin-engine design, like the Lockheed P-38 Lightning, not only meant that the aircraft could fly if one of its engines stopped working, but also having the two propellers on the wings left the nose wide open to mount a machine gun without needing any synchronizer. It was these advancements that propagated the tractor configuration universally, reducing pusher aircraft to a tiny minority, even to this day. But there is arguably one more important reason why we see a lot more pullers than pushers, and that's increased dynamic stability. The air pushed back by the propeller increases airflow over the flight surfaces. This creates drag, but it also creates lift at the wing roots and provides some authority to the elevators, to the extent that you can lock the brakes and apply enough power to lift the tail. Plus, having the engine in the front makes the aircraft nose heavy, much like a dart, which means pilots can more easily recover from stalls. History shows that the way to push aviation forward was by pulling it. But the pusher design didn't die. In a way, it evolved into today's ubiquitous jet engines, which by definition are pushers and clearly dominate the world of aviation. Oh, and in case you're wondering why other vessels like ships still have their propellers on the back, that's an easy one, because the backside of the ship is the safest place for a propeller, as it reduces the likelihood of damage from foreign objects in the water. Hey there, we are hiring. If you think you're a scriptwriter who can match our caliber of research, or if you're a video editor who can source quality footage like we do, we're looking for you. Click the link below to apply and become part of Not What You Think.